Hey guys, this is Dr. Sangeeta and welcome back to another lecture of Dental Parchala where we help you understand and learn dentistry better and easy way. And we have a special guest today because we have surgery video coming up which you all have been waiting for. So meet Mr. Venkat. So today's video we are going to talk about the mid-facial fractures. As you know, mid-face is very important for the smell, vision, as well as for the resonance of the voice. Now if you talk about the voice, so the air sinuses, we have maxillary air sinuses, all these air sinuses, because of these air sinuses we have resonance in the voice. And the bones in the mid-facial fracture actually takes up all the mastication load. And if we talk about the mastication load, it is too much. You cannot even imagine. So somewhere around 70 to 150 pounds, that will be somewhere equal to 70 kgs. So that much of load our mid-face is taking for mastication. And we have something in the mid-face which actually takes up all the loads of the muscles. Now we have the pillars, we have the bone arranged in such a pattern that they are taking all the loads of mastication. So while we are chewing, so all the load is taking up while we are chewing. Now you can see the mandible is actually elephant mandible, which we'll talk about in the fracture itself. So these bones of the mid-face are aligned in such a way that they are taking all of the load of mastication. Now there are pillars which are taking up all the mid-facial load, all the mastication load. So these pillars are known as buttresses, which we will talk about in the today's video also, and in the fracture, because these buttresses are taking up all the load. So it is very important that when we are doing the fracture management, then we are placing the fixation or we are placing the screws or the plates in the specific region in the buttresses. And as you can see, mandible is a long bone. But if we look at the facial bone, now we have so many small bones which are attached to each other, and that forms the mid-facial complex. So these bones in the mid-facial, they articulate with each other. So as you can see, this is the zygomatic bone, which is aligned with the maxillary bone. So like that, one bone is articulated with each other and therefore they make a complex. So there is not a fracture of individual bones. So there will be a fracture of combination. So there is not independent fracture of mid-facial. There will be a complex of the other fracture also. And the bones of mid-face are very thin. As you can see, these bones are very thin. So these thin cortical bones, as well as there are trabeculae pattern which is present in the maxilla, if we compare it with the mandible. Now mandible is a strong bone, but if we look at the mid-facial, there are weak bones, there are cortical. These thin cortical bones are made up of cancellous bone, so there is a porous structure, so they are very easily prone to fracture also. And because these bones are very fragile, so any force which is coming towards the skull, these bones are bearing. So any force, suppose if any injury is coming from down, so all of these mid-face is actually taking all of the stress. They are not letting the skull damage, or they are not letting the brain damage. So somehow they are protecting the brain, somehow they are protecting the skull and taking all the forces, taking all the traumatic forces on themselves, and they are crushing, and there is a fracture of mid-face while protecting for the skull or the brain. Also, these bones are protecting the vital structures such as eyes, brain and the spinal cord. So basically the mid-face is doing all of the protection work. So normally the mid-facial fracture is due to the sports injury or either a car traffic accident, any road traffic accident, assaults or any fall injury. So mid-facial fracture is not an individual fracture. It follows a set pattern of fracture. So today's video, we are going to talk about the mid-facial fracture. So without further ado, let's jump into it. Before we get started, make sure you subscribe to our channel and click on the bell icon. That way you get a notification as soon as I release a video lecture. So fracture is a discontinuity of the bone. So it can be based on the displacement of the bone graft. So a fracture, it can be a displaced fracture or undisplaced fracture. So a displaced fracture is going to be when the fractured segment, it get displaced from its position. And non-displaced fracture is going to be when the fracture segment is in its previous position. So this is going to be a undisplaced fracture or a non-displaced fracture. Also based on the completeness of the fracture, it can be an incomplete fracture. So this is going to be an incomplete fracture where the fracture is not completed. And there is going to be a complete fracture where therein the fracture segment is, the fracture is basically completed. The whole, there is the complete discontinuity of the bone, and also based on the penetration of the skin. So if it penetrates the skin, then we have the compound fracture. If there it penetrates, it's come out of the skin, then we have a compound fracture. So like this, there is a penetration of the skin is the compound fracture, and if there is no penetration from the skin, then it is a simple fracture. So like that we have the classification of the fractures. Anatomy of the face we have already covered in the previous video. So basically the bones of the mid face are very thin. So the bones of the mid face are made up of thin cortical bone which have less large amount of the cancellous bone. So they are very fragile. See, half of the bones I have already fractured. The ethmoid bone is fractured in the skull. So most of the bones are very fragile, and because of these fragility they are very prone to trauma. So they can easily fracture because there is a lot of cancellous spaces which is present in the marrow, which is present in the bone. So also there is a thin cortical plate. So these bones are very fragile. These bones, they are protecting, actually they are preventing, they are acting as a cushion. So they are preventing any fracture of the cranium base. So they are protecting the cranial base. So mid face can be described as a matchbox which is placed in the cranium, which is covered by a hard shell. So any strong blow in this region is first going to go through the mid face. So if there is any strong blow to this region, it is first absorbed by the mid face bones, which get crushed first. And thereby this mid face is protecting the skull, it is protecting the bone, it is protecting the eyes, it is protecting the spinal cord. And as I have mentioned earlier, these mid face, the bones of the mid face, they articulate with each other. So there is an articulation of the mid face, like the zygomatic bone is articulated with the maxillary bone, like that, and orbital bone. So like that they are articulated with each other, and these bones, they take a load of mastication. So they take the forces of mastication. Now forces of mastication are very big, as far as the 70 to 150 pounds. So if we convert into kgs, it will be somewhere around 31 to somewhere around 70 kgs. So can you believe it? We are taking 70 kgs of the load. We can chew up to 70 kgs. And also these bones are fragile, as I have told you. But they have some force because they are taking so much of mastication load. So they have something known as the pillars in the mid face. So these pillars in the mid face, which are taking all the loads of mastication, are known as the buttresses. As if you have seen in the ancient building, the walls of the ancient building, they have buttresses in the walls. So they support, they have something support, some support for these walls. Like that we have buttresses in the face, when the mid face, in the skull, which takes up all the loads of mastication, which takes up all the load. So these buttresses, they transmit, they take the force and transmit it to the cranium structure. These forces, they first take the force within and then they transfer it to the cranium. And these buttresses, we have the vertical buttresses and the horizontal buttresses. Now these are providing strength to the bone. And also when we are fixing, when there is a fracture which is occurring, we are placing these plates, mini screws, plates, mini plates, screws, like that. When we are doing the open reduction, when we are doing surgery, when we are opening up and we are placing the plates or the screws, we are placing at these buttresses. So this is very important that we know the buttresses, because if we don't know the buttresses, then we cannot just plate, we cannot just place plates anywhere. We have to place it along these buttresses. Now we have two kind of buttresses, the vertical buttresses, the horizontal buttresses. The vertical buttresses, the first one in the vertical buttresses is the nasomaxillary buttress. These nasomaxillary buttress starts from the canine region, so starts from the maxillary canine alveolar process, and it goes towards the lateral wall of the pariform aperture, and it goes towards the maxilla and the frontal process, and it goes towards the maxillary. So the frontal process of the maxilla and towards the frontal bone. So this is the nasomaxillary buttress.
which takes the turn towards the lateral wall of the nasal aperture. So that would be the lateral wall of the nasal aperture. This one is the nasomaxillary buttress. The second buttress in the vertical buttress we have is the zygomaticomaxillary buttress. So zygomaticomaxillary buttress, as the name suggests, it is going towards the zygomatic bone. This zygomaticomaxillary buttress starts from the second molar. It starts from the second molar and it goes towards the body of zygoma and it crosses the frontozygomatic suture. Now there is, I am going to show you in the skull also. So the frontozygomatic suture, and then it crosses the body of the zygoma and then goes towards the frontal bone. So this is the zygomaticomaxillary buttress. There is a pterygomaxillary buttress. So there is a pterygomaxillary buttress which is present in the posterior part of the maxilla, which goes towards the pterygoid plates. So when I am going to show you, see the towards the first one is the nasomaxillary buttress. So nasomaxillary buttress starts at the canine fossa, goes like this towards the lateral wall of the nose, and it goes up in the frontal bone. So this is going to be the nasomaxillary buttress, starts from here, lateral wall of the nose, goes above. Now next one is the zygomaticomaxillary buttress. So zygomaticomaxillary buttress starts from here. See, it starts from here, zygomaticomaxillary buttress, and to maxillary second alveolar process and the body of the zygoma, and it crosses the frontozygomatic suture. Now you can see, can you see this frontozygomatic suture? So it crosses the frontozygomatic suture and goes towards the frontal bone. So this will be our frontozygomaticomaxillary suture. The pterygomaxillary buttress, now this maxillary is the posterior part of the maxilla and towards the pterygoid plates. So these are the vertical buttresses. Also we have some horizontal buttresses. The horizontal buttresses are the superficial orbital, the inferior orbital. So this is the superior orbital. Then we have the inferior orbital, which is at the inferior orbit. And also we have alveolar processes. So at the alveolar processes of, we have alveolar process of buttress at the alveolar process of maxilla, buttress at the alveolar process of the mandible. So one in the alveolar process of the maxilla, one in the alveolar process of the mandible. Also we have a lower transverse mandibular buttress like this. So these are the buttresses. If we are fixing any plates, if we are doing open reduction surgical technique, then we are going to fix plates along these buttresses. And these bones of the mid face are actually directed 45 degree angle. If we compare, so these are actually from the lower teeth, these are angle at the 45 degrees. So these mid face bones are, these are angle at 45 degrees, and when there is a fracture occurring at any part of this mid face, so the fracture is going to be downward and backward. Also in the pterygoid plates, there are muscles attachment. So the fracture, whenever fracture happen any of this mid face, there is going to be the downward and displace and the backward displacement of the maxilla, and from back it is attached, right? So from back, these, there is attachment for the soft tissues, there is attachment for the muscles. So when any fracture happens in the mid face, it is going to be like this. So there is going to be an open bite, which is seen in all the three Lefort fractures, and also elongation of the face, which is in the Lefort, all the three fractures. And we have already covered Lefort 1 and Lefort 2 fracture in the previous video. So talking about Lefort 3 fracture. Now that we have already know that Lefort 1 and Lefort 2 fracture are the subzygomatic fracture. These are the fractures below the zygomatic arch. So this is the zygomatic arch, below the zygomatic arch. And Lefort 3 fracture is above the zygomatic arch. So this one is our Lefort 3, the suprazygomatic fracture, as well as a high level fracture, because this at the mid facial, the Lefort 1, Lefort 2 and Lefort 1, Lefort 2 and Lefort 3 is at the highest level. That is why it is also known as the high level fracture. So talking about the, now this is a basically a blow at the face. So if any injury occurs, and if any injury occurs at the, because this fracture starts from the frontonasal suture. So this one, if you can see, is the frontonasal suture. See, this is the frontonasal suture. So if the fracture starts at the frontonasal suture, so if any injury occurs at this area, suppose if there is a strong blow to the face at the level of the orbit, or from any direction towards the frontal bone or the nasal bone, is going to be a Lefort 3 fracture. Now Lefort 3 fracture, the fracture line runs from the frontonasal suture.
So the fracture lines starts from the frontonasal suture and it runs across the nasal bone, it goes towards the lacrimal bone and the ethmoid bone is already fractured. Now I have to explain you in this because this orbit is much better. So the frontonasal, from the frontonasal suture, then the lacrimal bone, and after that lacrimal bone here, the ethmoid bone is basically missing. That this I have shown you in the first part of the midfacial fracture. So talking about the, then the thin orbital part of the ethmoidal bone is there, which is already fractured, and then it goes into the orbit and then it extends to the optic foramen. So if you can see this optic foramen, if you can see this part, this foramen is our optic foramen. So this is the optic foramen. So this foramen, and then after that we have, this is the superior orbital foramen, this is the inferior orbital foramen. So the in which is towards the inferior border of the orbit is the inferior orbital, and which is at the superior border is the superior orbital foramen. So this is the superior orbital. So talking about when the fracture lines from the frontonasal suture towards lacrimal bone, then the ethmoidal orbital plate of the ethmoidal bone, and then the optic canal. When it enters the optic canal, now what happens is, since this optic foramen, it is surrounded by a dense bone. As you can see, the ethmoid bone is fractured, but not towards the optic canal. So the next it comes from the optic canal, there is a ring of the dense cortical bone which doesn't fracture easily. So if this fracture get redirected and it goes downs and backward laterally, it goes posteriorly. So instead of coming up here, it is going down. So this fracture, it runs down. As you can see from the optic canal, it goes down, 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 and the superior, it comes towards the inferior border of the inferior orbital foramen. So it comes towards the posterior end of the inferior orbital foramen, and here the fracture line is divided into two components. The first one is the fracture line. It goes, now see, I have placed this probe, the back end of the probe, in the inferior orbital fissure, right? So if I'm going to take it down, so this part is the inferior orbital fissure. Now you can see this part is the inferior orbital fissure. So now this fracture line, it comes down and it fractures the, here we have the pterygoid plate. So it comes, this fracture, the first part of this fracture is, it comes down posteriorly aspect of the maxilla across the pterygomaxillary fissure and it fractures the pterygoid plate. So here is the pterygoid plate. Now the Lefort 1 fracture, if you remember, it fractured the pterygoid plate at the low level. So this is the low level fracture. Then in the middle we had Lefort 2 fracture, and here at the base is the Lefort 3 fracture. So this is the difference. So first line is from here, from the posterior border of the infraorbital fissure. There are two things. The first line, see, the inferior orbital fissure. So from inferior orbital fissure, this is the inferior orbital fissure. So this line comes down, this fractures, becomes like this, and it fractures the pterygoid plate. So this is the first line. The second line is, the second line runs, it laterals. It runs lateral to the inferior orbital fissure. So it goes lateral to the inferior orbital fissure and goes towards the zygomatico, frontozygomatico suture. So if you can see this frontozygomatico suture. So this one is the frontozygomatico suture. So it comes from here, it goes, comes here and fractures the frontozygomatico suture. So this is the second line. Now, because it is breaking from here, and breaking from here, so whole of the complex, whole of the mid face is get separated from the cranial base. So middle third of the face, when it gets separated from the cranial base because of this Lefort 3 fracture, this is also known as the craniofacial dysfunction. So Lefort 3 fracture is also known as the craniofacial dysfunction. So let's just go through once again the fracture lines. So the fracture line we have is the frontonasal suture. From here, it goes inside the lacrimal bone, inside the ethmoid bone, and inside we have the optic canal. So this is the superior orbital fissure, inferior orbital fissure, like that, right? So the superior orbital fissure, inferior. So towards the optic canal it goes, it comes inferiorly, and one of the part,
It goes towards the, so divided into two parts. One line goes into the pterygomaxillary fissure and towards the root of the pterygoid plate. And the another one, it goes up lateral. It goes laterally. This is the medial. This one is the lateral. So it goes laterally towards the lateral wall of the orbit and goes to the frontozygomatic suture. And fractures the frontozygomatic suture. Now when it fractures the frontozygomatic suture and it is fracturing the pterygoid plate also, so whole of the mid face, whole of the middle third of the face, it comes out from the cranial base. So this fracture is because this whole of the cranial part is coming out. So this is known as the craniofacial dysfunction. So this is the LEAF-03 fracture, which is also known as the craniofacial dysfunction, the high level fracture, because this fracture is occurring at the high level. And suprazygomatic, as you can see, this is a suprazygomatic fracture. Now LEAF-01, LEAF-02, we have covered were the subzygomatic fracture. Now coming to the signs and symptoms. So signs and symptoms for the LEAF-03 fracture is, first of all, because the fracture starts from the frontonasal suture. So there is going to be depression of the whole of the this part. So there is going to be, first of all, because there is a fracture of this part, right? Whole of the middle cranial faces get separated. So there is going to be edema. There is going to be swelling all over the face. So again, the face looks like earlier with the face which was like this of a person. So earlier the face which was like this, now the face has become, because of the swelling, like this. So this is a moon face, because there is a gross facial edema. There is a swelling all over the face, so it looks like a moon face. So there is, because of the fracture of, because there is a lacrimal bone fracture, then there is a ethmoidal bone fracture, and because of this fracture there is a periorbital ecchymosis. Sometimes there is a slip of tongue. So because this is the eye, right? So this part, if you remember in the LEAF-02 fracture, LEAF-02 fracture we had only fracture of the lacrimal bone. But in the LEAF-03 fracture, because there is a fracture of the lacrimal bone, there is a fracture of the ethmoidal bone. Also, there it goes inside the optic canal. So, because there is a fracture of whole of the eye, we can say there is a periorbital ecchymosis. So, whole of the, there is all around the eye, there is going to be ecchymosis, darkening, black discoloration, right? So, like that, there is going to be black eye. But this eye is known as the panda faces. So, panda faces is basically, the face will become a panda-like and there will be ecchymosis on the face. So, there is a raccoon's eye. So, raccoon, as you have seen, the eye of the raccoon is like this, right? So, all over black, black, black. So, raccoon's eye is like this. So that is why it is also known as, because of the perioral ecchymosis. Because there is a ecchymosis, so that is why it is known as the raccoon's eye. So we have the raccoon's, like that, the raccoon's eye is because there is a periorbital ecchymosis. So this is because there is a darkness of the skin, discoloration of the skin. So this is known as the panda faces, because there is swelling also. And there is raccoon's eye, because there is a periorbital ecchymosis. Now, there is also subconjunctival hemorrhage. Now, this subconjunctival hemorrhage, if we talked about the LEAF-02 fracture, because in the LEAF-02 fracture, there was only the fracture of the lacrimal bone. But this is starting from the medial wall. So, there was a fracture of the medial wall in the LEAF-02. But in the LEAF-03, the fracture is crossing whole of the orbit. So, there is going to be the hemorrhage, subconjunctival hemorrhage at the medial wall as well as the lateral half, because this is fracturing also going towards, if you remember, the second line is going at the lateral wall of the orbit. So because it is crossing also the lateral wall, so there is going to be a subconjunctival hemorrhage at the medial side of the eye as well as the lateral half of the eye. So the eye, if you see, it will be the whole red eye. There is inside, there is going to be a hemorrhage. And there is going to be the edema of the conjunctiva, which is known as the chemosis, which was also there in the LEAF-02 fracture also. And if the orbit is involved, see, because the orbit is involved, so there is going to be the impairment of the vision. The patient won't be able to see properly. And there will be restricted eye movement also in the case of LEAF-03 fracture. So when the fracture happens, because this is a fracture of the whole of the nasal complex, right? So when the fracture happens, again the nasal bone is like this, right? So this is like a nasal bone. When it fractures, this whole of the bone, it flattens. So the canthus, distance between the canthus also increases. So there is going to be increase in the intercanthal distance, widening of the intercanthal distance because of the depression of the nasal bridge. And also there is epistaxis through the nose. There is going to be bleeding coming from the nose as well as the CSF rhinorrhea. Now we have a reason for CSF rhinorrhea because of the fracture of the cribriform plate. I cannot show you cribriform plate from this view because I need a cross section. So if you see the cribriform plate, so there is a fracture of the cribriform plate of the ethmoid bone because there is a fracture of the ethmoid bone. So because of this, there is a seepage or there is a leakage of the cerebrospinal fluid. So this is the CSF rhinorrhea. When the CSF, cerebrospinal fluid, starts coming from the nose. So when the CSF starts coming from the nose, it is like a running continuous nose. But running continuous. So see, when you are sneezing, when there is watery running nose, when there is water coming from the nose, CSF rhinorrhea is also like a water coming from the nose only. But when you are trying to take it back, the CSF rhinorrhea, when the patient is having a CSF rhinorrhea and the water is coming from the nose, then you cannot take it back like this. When I have a running nose and if I'm trying to take my whole of the running thing back, it will come back. But in case of a CSF rhinorrhea, you cannot take the water which is coming, you cannot take it back because there is, and when the patient is bending the head, so much of water is, so much of CSF, I won't say water is, so much of CSF is leaking out and there are so many tests and CSF rhinorrhea is covered in a separate video. So because of the fracture of the cribriform plate of the ethmoid bone, there is going to be the CSF rhinorrhea. And also because there is a fracture of nose, patient won't be able to smell properly. So there is going to be anosmia, which is patient is not able to smell properly. And also because this maxilla is fractured, right? This whole component is fractured. So when this whole component is fractured, again the maxilla is pushed downward as well as is displaced backward because of these muscles, because of this soft tissue which are still attached at the posterior part, at the pterygoid plates. So the whole maxilla is going to be, because there is a fracture here, but there is still attachment here. So there is going to be a hanging like this maxilla, but there will still be attachment like this. So there is going to be hanging maxilla like this, but still we have soft tissue attachment at the pterygoid plate. So the maxilla is coming to be like this. So there is going to be open bite anteriorly. And also the patient's face, when you look at the patient face, we have talked about in the LIFO 2 fracture also, the patient's lateral profile, which was earlier like this, right? So what happens when there is a fracture of whole of this region, right? So what happens? The patient faces becomes like this. So whole of the face, whole of the nasal part, it get depressed, it gets inside. So this type of face is known as the dish face. So because the whole of the maxilla, it goes inside. Also when you percuss the teeth, there is going to be the dull sound on the percussion. And if you remember, we have already talked about cracked pot sound. So if you want to see the cracked pot sound, this is like when a potter is checking the pots. When the potter is checking the pots, he doesn't fill each and every pot because he don't have time to do that. So he taps the pot and he check. If there is a crack in the pot, then it sounds different. So when there is a crack in the pot, it sounds like a cracking noise, like this, like there is a cracking sound. But if there is no cracking, so it sounds like this, solid. So there is, when we are tapping, when we are percussing the upper anterior teeth, there is going to be a dull cracked sound in case of also a LIFORT 3 fracture. LIFORT 1 and LIFORT 2 also sounds the same. Also there is going to be a gagging of the occlusion, and sometimes there is a mid palatine split also. So this mid palatine suture opens up and there is a mid palatine split which happens. And if when
The eye level is lowered because of the unilateral facial, because of the unilateral L4-3 fracture. Now what happens? The eye, it gets lowered because of this fracture. If there is one side of the fracture, so one side of the eye, it gets lowered. And when the one side of eye is get lowered, basically the upper eyelid, it is pulled along with it, and the characteristic sign we call it the hooding of the eye. So now hooding of the eye is basically half of the eye is closed. So partial, there is a partial closure of the eye. So when the eye appears that it is half closed all of the times. So the eye which is supposed to be open like this, now the eye is closed like this in the fracture, right? So in this case, there is the hooding of the eye when there is a partial opening of the eye because of the L4-3 fracture. So this covers the L4-3 fracture, and we have covered the L4-1, L4-2, as well as the anatomy and classification of the L4 fractures, midfacial fractures. And next video onward, we will cover the management of the L4 fractures. So if you have enjoyed the videos, then please like it, share it, subscribe it. And if you enjoy watching our channel, and if you want others to learn as well, then please, please, please share it with your friends, so that others can also learn and I also get benefited, because I get more subscriber, and that way the knowledge also spreads. So this is about the L4-3 fracture, and that's it for today's lecture. I hope that you have enjoyed it. Give it a thumbs up and comment in the comment section below. So keep reading, keep learning, stay safe, stay home, and I'll see you soon for another lecture.